This episode is brought to you by Squarespace. Now, you can get started with a free trial if you go to squarespace.com. And there, Michelle, there is no credit card required.
Are you kidding me?
No, honey. It is just that easy. You know, and they recently launched their latest version called Squarespace 7.
What's that?
Well, it's a completely redesigned interface.
What did you call me?
You heard me. It's got new templates, and it's got this incredible new feature called cover pages.
Ooh.
Child, making a website has never been easier.
Let you say it.
Yes, right. Now, when you're ready to make a plan or purchase a plan or get on board with this thing, you'll get 10% off with the offer code RUE. That's offer code RU. Go to squarespace.com. Offer code RU. Y'all, we are back. Michelle, girl. Well, first of all, this is What's the Tea with Michelle Visage.
Hi.
I'm RuPaul.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you don't have to be a rocket science to figure out that, you know, we taped a bunch of shows.
Yes.
And now we're back together. And Michelle has been gone for a whole long time.
4 months.
Was it 4 months?
4 months.
My goodness. We have so many things to talk about. We want to talk about Big Brother. I want to talk about the tour with all the girls.
Uh-huh.
You guys did how many cities?
47, I believe.
Oh, my God.
Mind you, I missed the first 2 weeks because I was in the Celebrity Big Brother house.
Oh, the first two. Who hosted the tour?
Bianca.
She hosted when you were not
there.
She
filled in for, I think it was like 6 dates. It was 2 weeks in time, but, you know, there's travel and stuff. So it was like 6 dates.
Right.
Yeah.
And then of course, you've continued your weight loss.
Oh, that.
Which is crazy.
Aw, thanks.
You know, I've known you for 300 years.
So yeah.
You literally look like you did when I first met you.
Your check is in the mail.
No, it's true. It's
Rue,
true.
I met you when I was 17 or 18,
well,
so that's bullshit.
You look 17.
Oh, God bless you. God bless you.
So there's all that. And on top of that, you got your new book that is coming out. It's already available for pre-order at Amazon.com.
Yes.
And when we last spoke, you were trying to figure out what title you were going to call it. And you've chosen a title.
The Diva Rules. Because even divas need day jobs. We love it. Catchy. But we, as the editor read it, she's like, this really doesn't, it has so much more than just to do with day jobs.
Right.
And being a diva. So this is the Diva Rules, and it's about ditching the drama, you know, and finding your strength and sparkling your way to the top. Every chapter is kind of chronological in my life. Chronological.
Uh-huh.
In my life. But it's about, it's about how I kind of messed up in every situation, but how I was able to pick myself up, dust myself up, and try again.
What do you mean mess up? I don't know if you've ever messed up.
Meaning we all hit bumps in the road, and not just bumps that go up our nose.
Yeah.
Actual bumps in the road. And a lot of times those bumps take people down.
Yes.
You know, we've talked about this perseverance thing. So it's kind of like, yes, you have to acknowledge that's a bump. And you have to kind of now get over that bump and go on to the next one, because there's going to be bumps and humps and lumps every phase of your life, in every aspect of your life, parenthood, with your spouse, with your job, with your career. And it's about, do I be taken down by those or do I push forward? That's
right.
Where all the grit lies, you know?
Yeah, I know very well. You know, if you live on this planet long enough and if you're somewhat successful, even at just maintaining a livelihood or whatever, you know what those bumps are.
Yeah.
You know, there's my favorite line in this movie, A Night of the Iguana. And every time it comes on Turner Classic Movies, I just have to stop and watch it. And I break down every single time I see this scene. I don't know the exact lyrics, dialogue, but it's Deborah Carr has stopped Richard Burton from committing suicide. He's decided, he said, I've had it. You know what I've had? I've had it. I'm done. She has him tied down and she gives him some tea and he calms down. Because
that's the way it works in real life.
In real life, exactly. Yeah. But ultimately, he says, how is it that you know so much about dealing with what they call the blue devil, you know, the bumps in the road? She says, I've had my time with it. And she says the key is to persevere, mm-hmm. is to stick around longer and dig your feet in and just persevere.
Yeah.
Because the storm clouds will pass. You
That's
know?
Exactly what the book is about.
Yeah.
And it's not easy for me. It's not been easy for you. But there is a light at the end of whatever tunnel that is you're looking through.
Right.
And that's what each chapter is about, really. It's about being this girl who from the start wasn't wanted, was adopted by a family who did want her. So if you look at this, you know, heterosexual adopted girl in New Jersey to where I am now, it's kind of like my journey of how I got there.
And wow.
Really weird circumstances and how I ended up with the people being a misfit and you know, embracing that.
Now, do you ever see people from your old town, from South Plainfield, or people you knew from the performing arts school who say, hey, Michelle, you know, I've been following you all these years and I'm not surprised by it, or I am surprised by your success?
Ironically enough, the people that I do now, high school, there weren't many that believed in me in high school because I didn't really have many friends. I'm still friends. I was what you would call weird popular. I wasn't a popular girl, right. But I was, everybody knew who I was.
Yeah, same with me.
Right, because I was class clown and class actress type of thing, but I didn't have friends, so to speak. Like, people spent more time not liking me or making fun of me than they did befriending me. So I had my group of friends, and my best friend Laura that I've had since ninth grade is still my only friend from high school that I still talk to. There's the Facebook people that you talk to, and they're like, I'm so proud of you, and blah, blah, blah. There was a few people that I hadn't heard of in years that would say, oh my God, I always knew that this, you'd be the one. And that feels really good, because it's like, back then they didn't really say that stuff to me, or they didn't even acknowledge my existence. So for them to say that now as an adult, it's like, really?
Wow.
Thank you. But the people in college, it's usually the latter of what you said, which is like, I always knew that you would be the one. And it's so weird because I wasn't the prettiest. I wasn't the skinniest. I wasn't the most talented. But something, I guess, stuck with them that made them think that I had that it factor versus all the talent in the world. And a lot of times, and I was talking to the kids on tour about this, a lot of times that's what it comes down to. There's so many people, and let's look at any given singing show, mm-hmm. with so much talent, talent that could blow X, Y, and Z out of the water.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But because they don't have that X factor, that it factor, the career stops or never really truly begins. Look at all the winners of American Idol.
Yeah.
A perfect example, you know? The talent is beyond, but the presence is not. And it's really weird how important that is. And I'm not saying they have to be the best looking or the best body. It's just that it that you can't explain, that je ne sais quoi thing.
You're absolutely right. Because I've realized that audiences, they're not identifying necessarily with the music,
right.
or even the race of the person. It has to do with a part of their themselves that they see in that person. I remember when I first saw Cher, and Diana Ross and David Bowie, all of them, I saw myself.
Yeah.
And because as a youngster, I couldn't articulate my feelings, I could point and go at Cher and go, that's how I feel, right?
Yeah,
there.
Yeah.
Or David Bowie and being, you know, being everything, and he would reinvent himself. And I love that about being a human.
And you just said that perfectly, because there's a lot of kids out there now that are my newfound fans because of Big Brother, and they're 13 and 14 years old, and they call me mom, and they look at me as their mom, and I didn't understand what it was that they were identifying with, not just because they may be confused teenagers, which is normal at their age, 13, 14, 15, to be confused and not really know sexually what it is.
Sure.
But I think there's more to it than that. I think there's a part of me that speaks for them, or whatever it is. It was weird for me to come out to this influx of fans that are that age, and I couldn't understand why. And they'll tell my daughters, I wish your mom was my mom, type of thing. And it's like, what is it that they're identifying with in me? I still can't tell you what it is, but you just said it best. You could look at somebody, point, and go, that's it.
Yes. Yes.
That's what I'm talking about, to, with, and through.
That's exactly right.
It doesn't mean I want to be them or I want to love them. It's just, I get it.
Which is interesting, because you would think that because of that, people would be lifelong fans. But, you know, what happens is once a kid grows out of that area of his life and then and is able to articulate his feelings, then that pop star goes the wayside. And you've seen it. You think, wow, you know, Gaga has, you know, 40 million Twitter followers. Why haven't they bought the album?
I know. It doesn't translate.
Doesn't translate.
Isn't
in that
weird?
Same way. And, it's fleeting. Now, for me, of course, I'm a lifelong Cher fan. I'm a lifelong Diana fan. I'm a lifelong David Bowie fan.
Right.
Whatever they put out, whatever they do, I'm going to buy it.
Yes.
But most people are not that way.
No, which is why I made that statement when I did that Hey Queen interview about the backs, the gays turning their backs on Madonna. Right. It was more to do with that. Like, people went all up in, you know, up in arms over that because they said the young kids have no idea how Madonna paved the way.
Right.
And she really did.
She did.
And it's not their fault that they don't know. It's a matter, you know, we lost the education somewhere along the way. And whose job is it? My kids know who Madonna is.
Right.
I will, but this album is unbelievable for me. It's the best one in the past 10
I think
years.
So. Oh, I agree. Yeah. I was listening to it yesterday at the nail salon.
So good.
It's so good.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah. So for me, I'm like that with her. I'm like that with Cher, Bette Midler. There's certain people that I'll always love and support and go see. And by turning the backs, you just said it right there again perfectly. 40 million fans. Why aren't they not buying the album?
I don't know.
You don't have to like it. You're supporting your girl.
You're supporting the girl.
Yeah. You're supporting the artist.
Which is, you know, we have so many things to talk about. Michelle is back in town. We are going to talk about everything. We're going to talk about Big Brother. We're going to talk about the book. We're going to talk about Drag Race and the tour. You know, one of the things I do want to touch on is this season, season 7 of RuPaul's Drag Race, we have sort of turned a corner with how the fans approach the show. And I think it has to do with because the girls on the show are much younger.
Yes.
And I think our fan base has actually gotten even younger.
Yes.
And young people
don't mean to cut you off, but I do want to add to that. It's not just younger. It's way more diversified. And I can say this coming off a 4-month tour, that the diversification is so massive now, because when I first started doing this 2 years ago and going out and doing club gigs, I saw gays and drag queens. Mm-hmm. The end. Mm-hmm. And by gays, I'm encompassing every aspect.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm getting tons of hetero men with hetero women coming up. The men, of course, coming over to me because I'm the only one with a vagina.
Mm-hmm.
Their wives have turned them on to it. Their kids love it, whatever it is. And they're so open now and loving and get it and appreciate it as a viable form of art.
Mm-hmm.
So it just goes to show you that we've crossed all these boundaries, all these hurdles everywhere. It's no longer just what you would call a gay show, even though we own it. It's ours.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah.
And the fact is, it's now crossed over to mainstream, which is what everybody hopes for.
Which is what everybody hopes for. But of course, that what comes along with that, and I'm not mad at it, it's just a part of success. It's a luxury problem. But younger people who don't know that this is an anomaly, that this is not the norm in culture to have this kind of openness.
Yes.
You know, they go on social media and they are so evil.
Mean.
Just mean
terrible.
And evil in a way that's like, what did you say?
Yes. You can't.
You know?
Listen, I learned from you. And not just, I'm not going to talk about reading the comments here.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I'm going to talk about rising above.
Yes.
Because it's that rewarding bad behavior thing that I fought so hard in the Big Brother house. It's that addressing hate with hate, it just gets nowhere.
Exactly.
And this infighting in the gay community is the thing that's going to keep us out of mainstream, and it's the thing that's keeping us down.
And we'll unravel all of the advancements that have ever come before, like crabs in a boiling pot.
Completely.
That drag one another down.
Completely.
This is, we didn't come up with this thing. This is a cycle of humans on this planet.
Yes.
It happens to everybody.
No. And I say this all the time when we go to long, you know, we do our shows and I do a little monologue at the beginning and I talk about why it's so easy for children to come out of the uterus and shit rainbows these days.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not because of RuPaul's Drag Race. It's because of Marsha P. Johnson. It's because of Stonewall. It's because all these kids need to do is a little bit of research.
Mm-hmm.
And it will go miles for them. And they'll understand why it's so easy to be out and open and free these days.
Right. So it's this whole thing of where young people who are now new fans of the show.
And we love you.
And we love them all.
Yes.
Listen, this is the spoils of success.
Yes.
Don't understand that this show is not the norm. And they grew up with it being the norm. Do you know that this show could disappear in the quicker than you can bat your false eyelash? Do you know that we could be in, we could be, shipped to some island somewhere.
Yes.
Quicker than.
Think about all the shows, all the reality shows, let's take reality out of it. All the TV shows that get two seasons, and they're done.
Yeah.
And I often watch these shows and I go, I wonder what this person's going to do when the show is over. On these reality shows, especially.
Mm-hmm.
Let's use Jerseylicious. That's one because I loved.
Mm-hmm.
And I would sit there and I loved Tracy and I loved Olivia and I'd go, what's Tracy going to do when this show's over? And that's a very real thing.
Yeah.
And I talk to these kids about it all the time on the tour or when I do Whatcha Packin', and I try to set them up and say, listen, you are as hot as long as this show is on the air. So you need to set up your future now, whether it's saving $5 from each gig that you do, whatever it is, you need to prepare because this will not last forever.
Right.
Neither will YouTube. Neither of these things are fleeting. Fleeting. It's like getting in fame, like is like buying an IPO when it first comes out and you have the inside track. So you had the inside track to buying the IPO for eBay or Apple and you make millions off of it that moment. That's what Snooki did when Jersey Shore came out. Good for her. She made millions. Brilliant.
By buying stock? Is that what you said?
Buying stock in herself,
yes,
essentially.
Of course.
You know?
Yeah.
By saying, okay, I'm gonna make all this money as much as I can when I can. And she did it. And even if she never has another gig again, she made gazillions of dollars. Mm-hmm. So I try to tell the kids that are on Drag Race, what are you going to do right now while it's on? And what are you going to do when the show's off? Because mm-hmm. once the show's off the air, they don't want to hear it, but their career is done. More or less, of course.
Right.
I'm trying to like generalize.
Yes,
so.
Generalize. Yeah.
Always a few. Always exceptions to the rule. But they're few and far between.
But the ego will have you think that you are that exception. You know, I grew up loving all the Motown stars, but then all in the 70s and 80s, and actually in the 80s, they all start writing books about what went wrong and what went wrong with their careers. But just like in Rich Dad, Poor Dad, that book that you could probably find on Audible, you know, it talks about how if poor people who were raised with no money win the lottery, 5 years down the road,
they're poor again. Yeah.
Because it's deeper than just having money.
Yes.
Or deeper than, oh my God, I'm famous. Because if you get money, if you get famous, whatever issues you had before that, just it exacerbates
yes.
the whole issue.
It so, even exacerbates.
Yeah. Oh my God, I thought you'd never ask. And so, you know, but you know, so it's twofold what we're talking about. It's the success of the girls on our show, what happens to them and how they handle that success. It's also the fans who are benefiting from this new freedom that we've all enjoyed, not because of our show, but because of culturally a window has opened.
Paradigm shift.
Exactly.
Yes.
So there's this, but to use that, their power on social media to go and just bitch out and be hateful and nasty. You think, what are you doing? You're going to put that out into the world?
It's downright ugly. And it's also...
And you just started blocking people.
Just this... Literally this week. Because I'm always from the school of thought, I give everybody 18 chances. You know me, I give them yeah. way too many chances. And I figure they're going to tire themselves out like a rat on a treadmill. And they're just going to get exhausted of the fact that I'm ignoring them. I'm not
right.
answering them.
Right.
So they're going to be like, what is this for? This is pointless. And most of the time that happens. Mm-hmm. But now they keep going and going. And I really feel like I'm here on this planet to do God's work, to do positive work.
Kirk Franklin.
Okay. Uh-huh. I'm trying to do good work for the gays here. I'm trying to make a change. I'm trying to make a difference. And I can't do that with this negativity in my window or in my
right.
realm.
Sure.
So you could say whatever you want about me. It will not hurt me. Honestly, it will not. It took me 46 years to get to this point where I do not care at all what you have to say about me, but don't at me, leave it off my timeline.
Right.
Say, you can hashtag me to the cows come hunger, but leave me out of it
right,
because
right.
I don't care what you have to say.
I'm surprised that you weren't blocking. I, you know, in this season seven in particular, I feel like we turned a corner and there's younger people and there's a lot of nastiness.
Well, when I was young, I was
media.
The same way, weren't you?
No, I was never. I was never ever. You know what? I was too sensitive to hurting other people's feelings than to say something nasty to someone.
The opposite.
And same with like I never liked pranks, like prank jokes.
Yeah.
I never liked the idea, even on television
cruel.
Today, because if the other person doesn't know, if you sideswipe someone, it does something to me.
It doesn't sit right with it.
I can't sit right with it. But listen, you know what? I've been blocking people as soon as I
know you have.
From the very beginning.
I'm following you. It's the right way and it's the right message. And then they come back and they say, why Rude block me? And I knew in my head, I know why Rude
No, there's only
you.
One reason
yes,
I would block you.
Yes.
There's only one reason. And it doesn't take, a psychic to figure
Listen,
it out.
Bianca is hilarious. Bianca blocks everybody if they say one negative thing. If they say, if there's a picture of her in Adore and they comment about Adore's lips or Adore's outfit.
Yes.
Block.
Good.
Block.
Good.
She won't even think twice.
Good.
No room for negativity. And I've kind of come into that new school. I'm not going to try to defend myself, my actions, my words. I do what I do. They have to remember that being a judge in a reality show is not, it's my job. It's what I do for a living. It's not who I am as a person. It's the most ridiculous thing in the world that you would come for somebody because they made a comment you didn't like about their favorite drag queen.
Right.
Are we losing sense of reality
but
here?
You know what? And I've said this to you before, Michelle. It really has nothing to do with you. It has to do with them trying to show off for their friends
of
who
course.
Are also following them.
Of
so
course.
It has. So I'm like, that's why I'll block them, because it's like, you know, you're trying to front for all your little friends.
Yes.
And go do that. That's fine.
Yes.
But, you know, like you said, leave me out of it.
Just leave me out of it. I love you. I love you watching us. But guys, there's no room for hate in our community. It took us this long for my best friend sitting here to get a TV show like this on the air. For you to try to come in and hurt it with your hurtful words, ain't nobody got time for that, kids. We're trying to do good things here for the community. And in order to do that, positivity needs to be remain in the upper echelon here.
Right.
Taking all the sludge and bringing it to the surface is not what we need to do, because that stuff always exists. So we need to shine light on the positive stuff. The positive stuff is there are kids out there doing all this hard work for a craft that is an art form that is beautiful and hasn't been recognized up until this point as a viable form of art.
Yeah.
And it now is. So we need to keep the positive on it, not the negative. If you're not happy with who Rue sent home, then you can just take that and go have two seats.
Well, in my mind, I'm always thinking, bitch, when you get your show,
then you can
then
say, what
you can
you
say
want.
What you want. Right. But what's funny, and we're going to take a break in a minute and talk about Big Brother, but what's funny to me is that people are like saying, bring this one back, bring justice for that one.
Oh,
just
girl.
I'm like, bitch, you know, we filmed this shit 9 months ago.
They don't know. They think it's happening in real
time. It's like, and do you want me to, okay, because I could break it down for you, tell you, you're living in a fantasy world where you could go back in time and change and bring people back and shit.
You ain't going to win. What's the point? You ain't going to win. Like when the whole Trixie and Pearl lip sync happened, I said, people were trying to come, and I said, listen, I was there. Pearl won that lip sync.
Yeah.
You're talking about a Debbie Harry song. Pearl embodied Debbie Harry.
Yeah.
They both did great. Pearl embodied Debbie Harry. Trixie was bebopping all over the place. Not that she didn't do great, but to me, that's why Pearl won.
But devil's advocate, you know what? The night after that show came on, I went and saw Debbie Harry at the Carlisle in New York.
And
Chris Stein was there, and we all went upstairs afterwards and, you know, to the after party, you know, Jodeci and them.
Yeah.
And, we talked about the lip sync, and I said, how weird is it that this would be the week that that song would come on? And I said, I loved, you know, what the girl who won, I loved
Pearl.
What she did. And Chris Stein, who wrote the song, and Debbie were like, well, we kind of like Trixie.
Shut up! Shut up! Oh my god, that's hilarious! Hilarious.
Well, they're gonna. They want to be. They want to be judges on the
show.
Oh my god!
Yes.
They're rabid fans.
Well, of
the
Debbie
show.
Harry's an icon, needless to say.
That's
and
great.
And but the whole point in all of it is, everything that was done, I stand behind and I back it up. It's the same thing like when somebody was on social media saying, "See what happens when you listen to Michelle Visage? Max changed his hair color to black, and he went home." Yes. That's
right.
Exactly why he went home.
Yeah.
Not because he did the worst Sharon Needles impersonation ever on Snatch Game. That had nothing to do with it. And that was the challenge.
Yeah.
It had all to do with the fact that he wore black hair instead of gray.
Right.
You're so smart.
Yeah.
That's it.
Well,
no, honey. No.
But people are superstitious.
You
know, and the truth is, you know, we're going to take a break, I swear.
I do, but before we do,
Can
we just put out just this message for the people who listen? Use social media for good. Not for bad. Putting hate in the world is not anything we need. Forget about the gay community. Let's just say as human, the human race, we are crumbling. The last thing we need is all this hate put out there against one another. If you ain't got something nice to say, don't say it.
Yeah, listen, you know, you're absolutely right. The thing is, I don't know if the entity that does that hate stuff can actually hear what you're saying.
It won't,
but I will say this. It's like taking poison and expecting someone else to die. What you put out in the world is like a boomerang.
Yeah.
That really just comes back on you. And that's why it's important to always put out seeds of love, because you end up getting the result of that.
And I know at 14 years old, and I'm going to even go up to maybe 23 years old, that window, 13 to 23,
sure.
You're not hearing that at all.
Right.
You know everything. You don't want to hear it from anybody else. Ain't nobody got time for you to tell me what to do, because you cannot tell me what to do, because I know everything. So I'm just going to put that out there as we know what you're thinking, but I am telling you 100% what Ruth said is guaranteed truth. Karma is not a thing that's mystical and made up. Karma is very real. It's quantum physics. Kids, if you don't know about quantum physics, read about it, Google it, get a little Wikipedia synopsis of what it is. Everything that you put out in this world, 100% will come back to you. So all that hate shit you're putting out there, I promise you, it's not going to come back to you tomorrow, but it will come back. Think about what you say before you push send in 140 characters.
Hear, hear. And on that note, we're going to take a break and come back and continue this conversation about UK Celebrity Big Brother. I cannot wait to talk about that, Michelle.
Girl.
We'll be right back. Girl, it's time to talk about Squarespace. Squarespace is so fabulous. You know, they allow you to create your own website that is fabulous. And, you know, and it's so easy to get started with this thing.
Really?
Yeah. You just go to squarespace.com. No credit card required. In fact, they just launched a new version of Squarespace called Squarespace 7.
Nice.
Which has a completely redesigned interface, new templates, and this incredible new feature called cover pages. Honey, making a website has never been easier. In fact, I know a lot of people write to us and tell us about their websites. Michelle, you have an email somebody sent us.
I do. You want to hear it?
Yes.
His name is Adriel Cueva. He says, "Hey, kitty girls, I'm listening to your podcast as I write this. Felt the need to reach out and thank you. First, for being such advocates, entertainers, and all-around heroes for queens everywhere." Oh, that's sweet. "But also because of your show, I learned about Squarespace. Your podcast inspired me to start my own business, bringing my skills and expertise in recruiting, training, and consulting, and making it my own. I didn't know the first thing about getting started, but after hearing your praise for Squarespace, I was literally up and running in minutes. It's truly amazing and has helped me in my personal evolution into being an entrepreneur. This made it so incredibly easy to get started that I was able to take those first scary steps on my own. Now I'm happy to report that I've been able to be successful and not have to worry about anything too technical getting in the way. Thanks again to all of you. You and Michelle inspired me to make a change, and Squarespace made it easy to do." So his website is www.primetimeconsult.com.
So Adriel is a consultant.
Yep. Isn't that amazing? He said he spent years working as a global for a global recruiting firm.
Right.
And now he's on his own doing it.
I love it. Now, that's what makes Squarespace so amazing. It allows you to put your career, your future in your own hands. And listen, guys, if you want to do like Adriel, go to squarespace.com. There's no credit card required. And if you're blown away by this and you're ready to confirm a plan, use the offer code RU to get 10% off.
I love it.
You'll be getting a great deal, and you'll be helping to keep What's the Tea free.
Holla!
Yes. And also, you know, I'd love to see your websites that you've created through Squarespace. So send a link to RuPaulPodcast@gmail.com. And go to squarespace.com and get that offer with the offer code RU.
Yeah.
All right, we are back with Michelle Visage. Have not seen this girl in forever and trying to catch up. I'm sure everybody out there wants to catch up. You know, we had taped a bunch of our podcasts in advance knowing that you were going to be, you know, sent up the river, so to speak. You know, we all here in America and all the fans of Drag Race, we watched you on YouTube on Celebrity Big Brother, because that's how it comes on.
Yes.
So, wow, what a gas. Okay, first of all, how do we begin? Okay, this was something you wanted to do for a long time.
Because I've been a fan of the show for years.
Yes.
Yes.
And how did it compare to being a fan of the show and actually being in the house? What was the big difference?
Well, first, you have to get over the surrealism of going into a house that you've watched on TV for all these years. And by TV, I mean YouTube. I'm a huge fan of the show, and I continue to do so. So walking in for me, it was that moment of, I have no idea how, A, I'm going to be perceived, B, going to be received, see what it's going to feel like walking in. And it was so surreal, real, literally. My anxiety issues were really there for probably a week and a half before I went in. I was having brain fog and depersonalization. And I didn't feel anxious, but the minute I went in, all of it went away. So I knew it was anxiety.
How long were you in the UK before you entered the house?
3 or 4 days.
Just 3 or 4 days.
Because we had to do press beforehand.
Right.
And you do it like in hiding, and they take you and they cover you. You have to wear like a burqa pretty much, or a beekeeper's costume.
Because they don't want anyone to know who's going in.
Everywhere.
Yeah,
correct.
Yeah. And so when you go into the house, does it smell? Because there are no windows, right?
There are, there's no windows, but there's an outside. Mm-hmm. So we've propped the door open.
So you can see the sky?
When you go outside, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, I know that's that outdoor area.
Yeah, the garden. So even though it's tented in with netting, mm-hmm. because people used to throw stuff over.
You are kidding
me. With notes and stuff, like tennis balls.
Yeah.
So they don't, it's not open anymore, but it's open. Yeah. There's open air. So it doesn't smell. But from what I've heard in the past before, it really, there have been houses that were terribly, terribly stinky.
Because you're all sleeping in this room together. Do you smell other people's body functions?
Okay, so... yes, there is that. Now, the thing is with the room shutdown, it's crazy because if you have anxiety issues, which I do, but not claustrophobia, uh-huh. they lock you in. So the doors go, doo-doo, and they lock, and then you hear, mm-hmm. and the shutters go down. Mm-hmm. So you are in a tin box. Mm. So there's snoring, there's gas, mm-hmm. there's talking, there's walking mm-hmm. in your sleep, all that's going on.
Is there sexing?
There's not. Yes, there is, but not in our house.
There was no sexing in you. But
thank God, because I find that so boring.
Right, right.
The sex houses I find so lame. Yeah. I like the houses with conflict and with personalities, which is, thank God, we were in the highest rated series ever.
Wow. So you like houses with conflicts. It feels like home.
Yeah, totally. Maybe that's why, you know.
Houses with conflicts. So, okay. So you were in with Perez Hilton and Katie Hopkins.
I was.
And Katie Price.
Uh-huh.
And there's that.
And Alexander O'Neill, who I know you'd love.
Yes, Alexander O'Neill.
Yes, that was amazing.
He was, I love the fact that he was so real.
So real, so hood. Like, yep. He kept it straight up. I was singing Saturday Love with him. And the thing is, I was sick for 3 weeks. I sounded like Big Ange.
That's right.
I was so sick.
What was that?
I was on a plane for 10 hours with a sick child flying in. And as it was happening, I went, guess what's going to happen?
Oh, dear.
I knew it was going to happen.
Yeah.
So the day after I got there and I was in my hotel, I felt it coming on. So I started bombarding my body with my natural remedies. And what happened was, mm-hmm. as soon as I got in that house, the doctor checked me the day before I went in. And there was air conditioning on each bed.
Yes, yes.
And it just would not let me heal. I saw the doctor 4 times when I was in there.
Did you get anybody else sick?
Other people got sick. Perez was starting to get sick. Nadia got sick. Patsy was starting to feel sick. So people were getting ill.
Yeah.
Cheggers was getting sick. And was it just from
Cheddars?
Me? Keith Chegwin. Cheggers.
Ah.
They were getting sick. Not just from me, but from... it's a sick house.
Sure.
You can't... it is. It's a sick house. It just goes round and round and round.
Oh my God.
Yes, Kevin Campbell.
Okay, right. So, So you were in there with Alexander O'Neill, who you and I both love.
Yes.
Okay, so how different is the experience from being a fan? I mean, so you had anxiety...
it's completely different because... let me tell you why. Mm. The most important thing... most important difference is watching it. I was like, oh no, if I was in there, if I was in there, I would have shut her up like bam.
Right.
It's not like that when you're in there.
Why did you ever shut, you did shut some people down.
I shut a lot of people down, but a lot of times you didn't see it. Now, when this used to be on Channel 4, they showed a 24-hour feed.
Oh.
But they also realized with a 24-hour feed, they can't edit it the way they want to.
Right.
So when it moved to Channel 5, they took the 24-hour feed off. So now they can edit it the way they want to. No disrespect. As a producer, you got to do what you got to do.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
I knew what they were doing. As soon as Pricey walked in that house, I went, oh, they want Katie and Katie. It's mm-hmm. obvious because they've been fighting in the press for years, those mm-hmm, two. Mm-hmm. Katie Hopkins took Katie Price's column in The Sun. Like, they've been fighting for years.
Mm-hmm. Wait, Katie Hopkins.
Katie Price used to have an article in Sun.
Yes.
They fired Katie Price to bring Katie Hopkins in to write that article.
I see.
Right?
Yes.
So they've been going at it for years. So I knew when she walked in, I went, oh, my head went, chicka, chicka, chicka.
Right.
Uh-oh, they want it to be those two.
Yeah.
That's what's going to happen.
Right. Now, by the way, are you allowed to talk about the show like this?
Why not?
Well,
I'm not divulging any secrets.
Well, but did you sign some type of contract where you couldn't say certain things?
No, there's nothing not to see. You see everything. It's filmed 24 hours.
Right.
So,
but they do
I
have
can.
The benefit of editing.
Yes, they do.
Yes,
which I understand because if you see me arguing with somebody and then you see Perez acting like a complete maniac over here, as a producer, you have to choose. What are you going to choose?
Sure. Right.
You're going to go for the crazy segment.
Right. And did you get to see the show yourself?
No, I've seen bits of it. I haven't watched it.
Right.
I don't know if I can relive it because it was really, really deep. But the funniest stuff, in my opinion, for the people that are listening, was put out by the BBUK Twitter feed mm-hmm. and on their website were the funniest clips that didn't make the show. But there were so many funny bits on there that I guess weren't dramatic enough for the TV show because they were following that whole Perez – storyline that the funny stuff didn't make it onto the show. And it's a shame because there were so many funny bits, but they still live on the BB UK website. So if, especially if you live in the UK, watch them. There are so many funny moments.
Wow.
So many, like watching them. Those are the ones that I did watch back. Dying. I was dying of laughter, howling. Because they're so stupid. Like when I tanned Katie Hopkins for the first time.
I remember seeing you in the with all the blackface on.
It was not blackface. That was tan. Katie Price tanned me.
Okay, so what is that stuff? And she has to do it every night. What about the pillowcases? Don't they get
brown.
They get brown.
Yeah.
And so it's not put over all of the skin. It's just put on some of the skin.
She does her whole entire body. Every other night, more or less.
Right.
And she did me twice.
Yeah.
And I put it on and I was like, oh my God, I look tan. I didn't look orange.
Yeah.
I look tan.
What product is it? Do you know?
It was Saint-Tropez. Saint-Tropez tan.
Oh, Bain de Soleil?
No. Saint-Tropez. That's the company.
That's the company.
And it's just the self-tanner. You use a mitt and you put it on.
Oh, you use
a
mitt.
So then I put it on Katie Hopkins and it was one of the funniest bits ever because I had no idea what I'm doing. I'd never done it before. Yeah. And basically I looked like, she looked like she rolled around in a mud bath. She did it so perfectly and evenly on me. Uh-huh. I did it on her and she looked that was peeing in my pants literally when I was putting it on her. Funniest thing ever.
I gotta say, I fell in love with that Katie Hopkins.
Of course you did.
I loved her.
Now, this is where...
Now, I know her politics or whatever. And, you know, the people who do that, it's almost like drag. It's almost like a character that they play. I'm sure parts of it she believes. Actually parts of it I believe too. Mm. But I'm not to that extreme of, you know, I'm like live and let live. But I love that woman.
Here's me in the middle. Let me tell you how it went down for me. I went in there, right? Knowing that Perez was going to be in there and knowing that Hopkins was going to be in there. And I hate everything Hopkins stands for. I'll say it now. I've said it 20 times. I said it to her face the first time I met her. I think it's disgusting what she does. But I went in there with a clean slate. I said, I'm not going to judge you, Perez, for what you did to us for season 3 of RuPaul's Drag Race, which I totally told him about the first night that we were in there. And what he did was he put on his website who won season 3. It was the first season I was on the show. It took us so long to get a show like this for our community on the air. And he went and put the winner.
Yeah.
And I confronted him on it. And you know what he said to me? He said, I'd do it again because it's my job. And I said, I'm not looking for an apology. I'm just telling you why I thought it was wrong. It took us this far to get a show like this. And you went and did that. And he said, then you shouldn't have loudmouth queens working for you. I said, are you hearing what you're saying? Or are you hearing what I'm telling you?
No, he can't hear it because if he heard that, he would deconstruct his whole belief system. He would fall apart.
I said, you changed.
He can't hear that.
He told me he changed in 2010. I said, if you changed, then you would be hearing what I'm trying to say to you. I'm not looking for an apology. I'm telling you why I was so upset with you. That's why I was disappointed in you, because why would you do that to your community? You should be supporting each other. It's not your job to tell everybody who won. And he's like, I put a spoiler alert. I said, it's not the point. Nobody needs to know who won. Let them go for the journey. So that started that whole thing. And that was the same night that I said to Katie Hopkins, I saw your fat documentary, and I think it's disgusting that you're fat shaming these people. I said, I love what you're trying to do to get attention for obesity. I said, but name calling and shaming people is not the way to do it. And she said, okay. She was open to what I had to say. I came for her a few times and shut her down in the house, and you didn't see any of it.
Mm.
She was trying to come for Katie Price with using benefits for her
kid. I saw that. Yeah.
And I said, hold on a minute. She pays taxes too. And they didn't show any of that stuff, you know, and I started getting into it. But anyway, the thing with Katie Hopkins and me is very simple. Humans cannot understand that I can like a person who they are and separate them from their job.
Sure, absolutely.
They can't wrap their head around it. I think what she does, and she's crossed a line this time for me with talking about the migrants and the immigrants and saying that they should be killed because human lives are human lives.
Right.
And we have an issue with, you know, that stuff happening, immigration issues in this country as well. I don't believe that anybody should be there with guns against their head shot at the border for trying to get a free life. Their lives are horrible in some of these countries. I would do the same thing in trying to break free for freedom.
Sure, yeah.
So for her saying that they should all be killed and calling them cockroaches is disgusting. And I can't support it. I'm sorry.
No.
But at the same time, I work with drag queens that are the most irreverent, politically incorrect human beings. So for me, not to have a little bit of leeway or give with her would be hypocritical to who I am and what I do for a living.
Yeah.
Why she does it as a living and can lay her head down at night and get paid for it and be okay, it's hate money. It's like blood diamonds. It's hate money.
You're right. You're absolutely right.
And it's gross. But that's her choice, not mine. I like her as a human and the person that I knew, and she's funny and witty and gets it. What she does for a living, disgusting. So Perez said to me, how can you do that? Because if she was a homophobe, I know in a million years you'd never be friends with her. And I said, you're right. But I would try to change her mind. And that's what I was trying to do, which is why I felt I made Katie Hopkins more likable.
You know, it's interesting living in a house like that. You know, politics aside or viewpoints aside, you know, on a human level, that's what I fell in love with from her. And how she displayed and played herself on the show, I like that.
Yeah.
Some of the other people, not so much. Certain character defects that... that's where I draw the line.
Well, that's why I was drawn to her. I don't like her stuff, her political stuff. I wish she didn't even have that in her life.
Actually, I don't even know. I know that she does some of that sort of Fox Newsy kind of stuff. Like
she's Ann Coulter. She is.
Yeah, exactly. She's that kind of stuff. And I understood that. But this is just based on what she was doing in the house. I fell in love with her.
Right, right. You know? Well, as did I, obviously. It was an unlikely pairing. And, you know, what she was saying in the diary room, I wasn't privy to. It's like watching RuPaul's Drag Race and I'm judging the challenge on the main stage. I don't know anything that they've been through in their life. I don't know how they are, if they're evil, nice, you know, whatever their life's been, if they were alcoholic parents, I don't know. Mm-hmm. So I didn't know her story. All I know is her as a person in that house. And I knew a little bit of what a hateful human being she was on the outside. But like I said, I went in with a clean slate.
You know what? I think of that stuff as posturing. And I think of it as that's their job.
It is their
job. As a shit stirrer.
As a pantomime villain.
Yeah. You know, I don't know. We were talking about this earlier, you know, this song that I'm loving at this moment. I'm not going to say who the singer is, but I really can't stand the singer. I just with their energy and stuff.
Yeah.
But the song is so good. You can't deny that part of it. And I think even as a fan of certain superstars, you know, who have met in person and had dinner with, you know, who I wouldn't want to have dinner with again.
Right.
But I still admire... the music. I still listen to their music or watch their movies or stuff.
Right.
So you have to separate people from the human and what their human character, their moral compass is from what, you know, what their job is.
No, they can't. They can't. They cannot. This is what I'm experiencing. People cannot. They'd rather say, well, good on you for supporting your hateful human being of a friend. How do you feel about that now? Instead of saying, this has nothing to do with me. That's her.
Right.
Why? Because I like her as a person and I know her as a person. Why do I have to be supporting what she says out there? No, because I don't. I don't support what she says. And I don't think what she does.
If you've ever listened to certain politicians, I don't think she believes all of that stuff. I think she's actually shit stirring. I think that she knows what her job is and she's an instigator. And I think with politicians, you ask them a straight up question and they will give you this double talk answer that would really speaks to their constituency.
Right.
It's not what they really believe, you know? And it's an interesting thing that...
It is. But the interesting thing is being a person on the other side and being able to see that. I can see that.
Mm-hmm.
You can see that. I know what she does for a living.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously. And she literally basically said outright, if I was nice and talking about obesity, who would pay attention?
Mm-hmm.
And that's what she said straight up. And what am I going to say to that? I don't like her fat shaming and calling people fat. I've dealt with my weight issues my whole life and had two fat parents. So it affects me differently.
Mm-hmm.
And people are overweight for different reasons. She doesn't want to hear all that. What she wants to do is bring attention to it. And she's doing it in a horribly shameful way.
Right.
I don't condone it, but I hear what she's saying about not paying attention. But at the same time, people do not see what you're saying. Yes, she does it for a living. It's how she gets paid.
Mm-hmm.
People have a hard time dealing with then, but how can you accept that? How can you say it's okay to do that? But I'm not saying it's okay. I'm saying that's who she is. If she's going to do it, let her do it. I'm not doing it. I don't believe in it, and I don't say it.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny because, you know, some of the things that I will say around the house, some, you know, George is Australian, and, Matthew's Australian, and we say lots of things. We don't say them in public.
Right.
You know, but we say lots of things that are off color. But you know what? What it is, especially with gay people or even with black folks, because it's a given that we've suffered and we've done all this has been done to us, it gives us the right to turn around and be racist. Like my family, black folks, some of the most racist things you ever want to hear.
Mm-hmm.
But it's under the basis that, okay, we've suffered so much, we have the right, we've earned the right to go ahead and talk like this. Same with gay folks. You know, we say all kinds of stuff, but it's under the auspice, is that the right word, of saying, you know, of that, you know, we've been maligned and it's justified and it's coming from love. Like if I call you, you know, some derogatory gay term,
granny.
I don't think that's a
it's not, but no, all of a sudden it is.
But
we're not
if I called you
that,
an F, you
okay,
know,
right.
And we're both Fs, we know it's a joke because I'm that, you know, and so we're taking it and we're owning it and we are making it funny.
Yes.
You know? But if someone else who did it, who hasn't come from the same struggle that we come from, does it, we know that they you have to earn the right to say the word.
Yes.
And we've earned the right to do it.
Right.
And so does it make it right? Does it make, you know, in mixed company, it's not a good idea to do that. But when you're with your family, you know, my mother would see some of the most racist things you could ever imagine. But she felt justified
Honey,
in doing it.
I work with drag queens, okay?
Thank you.
Day in and day out, which is why I have more tolerance for people like Perez and like Katie. I am not a person who feels like I need to take a moral high ground. I am not a person, of course, morality is important to me, but I work in the trenches. I am not a person who's looking to be the ultimate role model, who's a God-fearing woman mm-hmm. who makes casseroles every night. That's not mm-hmm. who I am. I can only live true to who I am in that moment. And in that moment, I found Katie very funny, very appealing. We had a good time. And I said at the end of the house, I didn't know she was calling Americans vile. And the one time she said it, I looked at her and go, well, hold on, I'm American. And she goes, no, you're British. And I was like, oh yeah, you're right. You know, it's comedy. It's jokes. Yeah. It's fun. Yeah. You can't take everything these panto characters do. It was like yeah. Omarosa here in the States. Uh-huh. You can't take everything that they do as gospel. And again, I'm not defending her. I'm not defending Perez, but I can only say me in that moment, I felt okay with who I was. And when I left that house, I left the same person that I came yeah. in as. I held my head high. I stayed true to who I was. I was very stoic. The only thing I was really concerned about in the beginning was that, you know, gay rights and equality is still very new in the UK and in the world. And I didn't want them to judge the entire gay community for the people who were watching it and going, see this why them gays, they're going to be Southern just because they're going to be Southern. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. This is why them gays don't deserve equality. See that, mm-hmm. that one right there? That's why we're not going to vote for equal rights. They don't deserve equal rights because look at him humping the window. Right. That's the stuff that concerned me. It wasn't funny to me. It was offensive to me
yeah.
because I didn't want people to look at it like, you know, this is what everybody
yeah,
is.
But you can't try to figure out what people are going to think. My strategy throughout this whole life has been to try to do my thing and fly under the radar and run away as fast as I can when
yeah.
it comes to I don't even want to know what people think
that
about
that was
things.
My mentality in the house, which is why people were saying, well, why didn't you, Katie was not bullying Perez. People are trying to, there's a few little tiny nuggets on Twitter of going, some advocate you weren't standing up for the gay man in the house was being bullied by your friend. Katie was,
she was giving him exactly what she was actually just reflecting, which
that's,
doesn't help.
No, because they were the same person.
Yeah, they were doing the exact same thing. And she knew as a strategy, she could try to do an intellectual come at him that way,
that
or
work.
She could try to face him with the exact same thing that he was doing, and that's what she chose to do.
Yeah.
I got to tell you, if I were in that house, I would have aligned myself with Katie Hopkins.
Yes!
She is the kind of a person, her moral fight, and politics aside, I have
yeah.
lots of friends who, we don't agree on politics, but as terms of a moral compass of like who you are and how you stand up, I would have sided with her.
Well, it's exactly who I was drawn to.
Yeah.
I mean, the kids that I was drawn to were rightfully the kids that I was drawn to. I tried to help Perez in the first week of that show. I really did. I was there for him. I was trying to walk him off the ledge a few times. And it wasn't until he turned on me, and you didn't even see the stuff he was saying to me, calling me an embarrassment to the gay community saying. And then at one point I realized, oh, this is about self-loathing and narcissism and hatred. This has something to do with me.
Yeah.
Why would you, of all people, condemn me for trying to be an advocate and an ally? So you're telling me equality is done everywhere and we don't need allies anymore? So if I were to speak up for Autism Speaks because I'm not autistic, I'm not allowed to speak up for them?
Right.
Or because I speak up for animals and I'm not a dog, I can't speak up for the ASPCA? You know, it just didn't start to make sense. So when he said that I'm not the voice of the community, and I said, I'm not trying to be, and I don't want to speak for you. I'm speaking for the kids who do feel like they need a voice and want a voice and don't feel like they fit in. And if they connect with me somehow, that's what I'm here to do. You're not gay. You can't speak for us. What? That is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. And that's why I said to him, you don't have a point. All you want to do is hurt me right now. Right. You just want to hurt me. And it made me sad that that happened that way. It didn't have to happen that way. And then it turned into some kind of crazy fuckery that I literally just had to pull myself out of. Saw 45 minutes, Rue. There's 24 hours of that.
Was there any time while you were in the house that you thought, I've got to get out of here? I mean, we saw it with other people. We saw it with Patsy Kensit, who her strategy was to sort of just be kind and sort of fly under the radar. But that's not what that show is.
No,
is
she
it?
Was begging to get out. Nadia was begging to get out at one point. For me, I never wanted to get out. I wanted to get to the final, and that's where I got, you know. And at some point, somebody told me that Katie Hopkins was in the diary room saying that my thirst for winning was clouding my vision. And I never once had a thirst for winning. Did I want to win? Yes. But who goes into that house and says they don't want to win?
Right.
Why would I ever join a competition that I don't want to win? What's the point? I want to win.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? So for me...
You never thought, okay, I'm pulling the plug.
No. I would do an All-Stars, again, in a heartbeat. Because I absolutely had a great time doing it. It was difficult being away from my husband and my kids. And that was the toughest part for me, not having any connection with them in the outside world. But I never once wanted to leave. I wanted to stick it out.
Well, what about when you had to go poo? What did you do?
Right. So there was one bathroom that was outside in the garden. It was the Versace looking bathroom with mm-hmm. the big hot tub and mm-hmm. everything. Mm-hmm. There was a lock on that bathroom. So I called it the poo loo. Uh-huh. So that's where everybody went to poo.
Yeah.
There's no cameras in the actual toilet. It's the only place where there are no cameras, in the shower and in the toilet.
And then what if you have a lady, your visitor, if you're a lady and you have your visitor, what do you do?
You just go to the bathroom, take care of madness.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
No, I mean, we all had it in that house. Uh-huh. You know, the ones of us that are still going through
biological.
It. Biological, uh-huh. which is debatable about me. But I had such a good time, Rue.
What was the biggest thing that most people don't know about being a contestant on Celebrity Big Brother?
That the boredom is the toughest thing to deal with. It's not the tasks. It's not the arguments. When that's happening, at least that's action.
Yeah.
It's the moments where there is literally nothing to do that I would look at Katie Hopkins or Katie Price and go, so do you want to go to another room? So then we'd get up and go to another room and sit down and talk. Or I'd put them in drag, or we'd tan each other.
Well, I saw you guys play. Did you guys play charades?
We played charades. I tried to do dirty charades, but they couldn't even really get charades. So we played charades a lot. Mm-hmm. Of course, they wouldn't show that. I sang so many show tunes and was singing so much. And every time we sang, they'd go, Big Brother's here to remind you that you're not allowed to sing commercial music, because they can't.
Right, because it's licensing thing. That's another thing. You know, the audience at home are living in this bubble where they don't realize how show business works. I've been doing this for many, many years. And my family, they will say things to me and I'll just smile, because they clearly don't understand that if there's a song on television, it has to be licensed.
Yes.
And you have to pay for it.
Correct.
And so you can't just say, why didn't you guys ever do any Mariah Carey songs on there? Because Mariah hasn't given us the permission to do it.
And that's the true story.
That's the true story.
Yeah. So I was singing all these songs and all these show tunes. My songs included everything. Alexander O'Neill was like, I own my songs. We can sing my songs.
He didn't write those songs, though.
No, he did.
No.
The ones that he was singing, he wrote.
Well, wait a minute.
Or he owns the licensing, because he said he could sing his songs.
Well. Huh.
Not Jealousy. What's it
called? Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis wrote those songs. He is a writer on those songs?
Clearly, because he said he wrote them.
Huh.
Unless he's crazy.
Well, I'm sure he wrote some of them, but the big hits are just Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis. Saturday Love is Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis.
Well, they didn't show us singing that.
Yeah. What did they show you guys singing?
They showed him singing. What is that song?
Fake or let's see. Oh,
it wasn't Jealousy. Was it Jealousy?
No, it's not Jealousy. It's I'm looking at the word.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Fake. Say Fake was a big one. Right. Yes.
Yeah. And then
he had the other one, and then he had Saturday Love with Sherelle.
Right.
But he sang one of them when we did the talent show, and I had to do the reading, and he did that, and But I guess the whole point of this whole conversation is we weren't allowed to sing. We were dying for music. So that's why when they gave us our little dance party with three songs, we danced like it was like, oh my God. It was like Chernobyl. Like we were like in
what
Russia.
What songs were they?
It's like Shake It Off by Taylor Swift. Uh-huh. And like, you know, I put songs on my list. One of them was Selma Houston. Uh-huh. Don't Leave Me This Way. Fergie, London Bridge. Like, uh-huh. I put songs that I just wanted to dance to, and they finally came on when we got to the really late on dance party.
Yeah.
So they had two dance parties. In the early one, there was three songs. By the time I realized that there was more than one song, I came out to dance, and the songs were over. It was literally three songs.
Oh, that's terrible. Yeah, I keep putting myself in that you Big would, Brother house.
No way.
And I would think that the part of my Scorpio would come out.
Would
and
you do
it? No, I would never do it. But if I were in that situation, my ability to be a diplomat would wane, and I would go ravenous on certain people.
But that's what you think.
I would go ballistic.
No.
And you know what? I would try to hurt them.
No,
like
you
hurt
wouldn't.
Them not with, physically,
mentally.
Not physically, but in a mental way that they could never recover from. And people don't know that about me because I'm fucking
I'm faking
this whole thing of hey, no, I'm not faking. I can do that. That's truly me. But I have to hold the other part back.
Correct.
From entering in and saying, you know what? Let me tell you something.
I've seen that.
And
part.
On Drag Race, when Pearl said that thing, she said, what, do I have something on my face?
Oh, how you held it back?
Well, I held it back because I was thinking, this is what I was thinking. I was thinking, I'm a producer of this. Because what I wanted to say was different from what I did because I thought I knew she was going to be a popular character and I didn't want to fucking go off and say, you know what, let me help you pack your fucking bags right now, bitch, because you're fucking out of here now.
right.
You know, I didn't do that.
No.
I said, no, you know what? She's a cute boy.
Yeah.
People are going to love
her.
You're
putting your producer hat on.
And I said, you know what? I'm going to let her do this
because
thing.
I was screaming at that TV like, I did not know she came for you. I did not know that.
Right.
And when I said, I was like, oh, hold on. Somebody needs to hold my earrings now.
Yeah. Well, also, you know, I knew some of her backstory and her family life. I knew that there were things that I couldn't really come for her in a way. She's already vulnerable.
Yes.
And I knew that it wasn't a cool thing to do. So I thought, you know what? I'm just going to.
But that's why I'm telling you, when you're in there in that situation and I saw Perez face to face, I realized he's not in control of what he's doing right now.
Right.
He's got so many other issues that he's dealing with, I'm sure, that me calling attention to them is not cute. For me to pick on him, make fun of him, that's not going to help.
But see, that's what Katie H. is.
She made fun of him. She picked on him.
And she knew that was the only thing that you could come with for fire for fire.
Yes.
And she knew there was no winning.
No.
You could only build the fire.
And I won. Because I walked away from him. I did not give him what he wanted. I did not reward bad behavior. I was not going to go down to his level. And I won. I won. I left that house to the most applause that anybody had. They were devastated when I came in fifth. When they kept me the first time, when Perez put me up for eviction, which he tried to say he did because he knew I was going to be saved, which is bullshit because he didn't like me. In the end, he says it's not. So me calling it bullshit is wrong. But
right.
I will say, I have never felt so loved and so engulfed by a community and a nation that for me, I really feel like I won. And that's not made up in pageant.
Right, right.
I swear to God, I feel like I've won that show.
Wow. I can't imagine what it's like for you in the UK now.
Unbelievable.
They must love you so much.
Which is why I'm trying to tell you when and you know this, how this is why I'm so passionate about getting our show over there. When it finally happens, we've got True TV, the seasons 4 through 7 coming up.
Yes.
June 1st it starts,
yeah.
Which is fantastic. But when we finally get the original series commissioned there, it's going to change the world. You are already changing the world there and you don't even know it. When you go and you see, you're going to get it. You're going to get it. Yes, my career has been changed over there. But I'm talking about our show in general and what it's done for the kids over there.
Wow. You know, actually, you know what? I've got to say, Michelle, you are looking so fantastic.
Thank you. Well,
you've got the book coming out. When I saw you, the first thing I said is, first of all, the second thing I said, one thing, but then the second thing I said was, what lipstick is that you're wearing?
Yes.
And you gave the answer that everyone around the world gives. They give one or two They answer this question with one or two responses.
Yes.
One of two responses.
Right.
I got it right that time. One of two responses. And your answer was?
Lady Danger. Max Lady Danger.
You know how many times I've asked that question and people have said, oh, it's Lady Danger.
But you know how many years I've avoided Lady Danger because I never wear orange base
lipsticks?
I know you don't. And then in the house, Katie Price tanned me and I was brown, like full on brown.
Yeah.
And Chloe Goodman had this only red and it was Lady Danger. And I was like, no, I don't do orange. She goes, just try it on. With a tan, first of all, this is the only color you should ever wear.
I love it. I
with
love Lady
your
Danger.
Color skin.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh my God, there is nothing more beautiful. And I became addicted to this orange because I usually wear the other red, which is Ruby Woo.
Right.
They're
that,
both
which, by the way, is the other,
the other
answer.
Red.
Whenever I ask someone, what lipstick is that? They say Ruby Woo
or
Lady Danger.
Well, Lady Danger is an orange based red. It's my new obsession. I think it's stunning. And it's absolutely good for every skin tone. So all the people who only wear blue based reds, which was like me, try it. Your life is going to change. I wore it every day. Every day after I tried it on until Chloe got evicted. And then I was like, oh, okay, I'm going to buy
Chloe's
it.
Chloe's the one who put the hair pieces in her head. Is she that one? Chloe? Chloe.
She's a really pretty 21-year-old girl, the bikini model. What hair pieces?
Who was the one who had the plastic surgery?
Alicia.
Alicia, exactly. Yes. She was gluing her hair up
girl.
In her head.
I found a piece of Patsy Kensit on the floor and I stuck it in my head.
Oh, Patsy Kensit had pieces?
It's just like little extensions. I picked them up and glued it in my head because I was like, look.
And which one's Chloe? Oh,
Chloe's
right.
Chloe's the little one, not Cammy with the tattoos.
Not Cammy.
But the other kitten, the other one that was with her all the time.
Oh, right. Yeah, she got eliminated early.
Yeah, she's the one that had the scandal with the Baywatch boy.
Yes, exactly.
With
right,
Jeremy
right,
Jackson.
Right. Yeah.
He was lovely. I loved him.
He was in the house too?
Yeah, for 2 minutes. And then he got really wasted. And then Chloe went in the bathroom to help him when he was puking. And he opened her robe and she had no clothes on and she flipped out. And they basically had to get rid of him because it was like almost a sexual assault.
Oh.
It was an awful event for both of them.
Yeah, I didn't see it. I came on board a little bit late because I think it was Theron who said, you could go on YouTube and
Theron's
see this.
Been he was amazing through this
well,
whole thing. Through the whole thing, it was amazing. And everybody out there, I want to thank you. I know we're wrapping up. I want to thank everybody who watched in this country specifically because it was so difficult to find. You donated money to vote for me. You did, like, you have no idea how my heart has swelled and grown. I feel like the Grinch at the end of the movie because I had no idea how impactful this show would be doing Celebrity Big Brother for us, for our show, for the community. And I'm so grateful that you guys showed me so much love and support. And the only reason I came out feeling the way I did is because of you guys. So thank you so much. I survived it. I do not wish any ill will on Perez at all. I understand what he was going through in that house. He's his own person. I'm my own person. We went through it. We've since talked. It is what it is. And, you know, he can have his opinion and I have mine. And Katie's got her opinion and I have mine. And I'm so grateful that I was able to do it. And all I'm going to say is when All Stars happens, be ready for me. Be ready because I'm bringing Hopkins with me.
Oh my goodness. Oh my God. I can't even imagine. I can't even imagine what that would be like. Honestly. I can't even stand to be. I'm such an introvert anyway.
Know.
But you know what you're thinking? But more.
Yeah.
So, you know, it would be interesting if you put me in an enclosed situation.
You couldn't even do a cruise for a week. How would you do it for a month?
Oh, hell no. I told you I did a cruise years ago. Yeah. I literally thought, I wonder what it would be like if I could try to swim to shore from here. I wonder if I could actually swim to shore.
Oh, my God. You're hilarious. I know you couldn't do it. And when they can't get you, they get me. So it's always second best. So
oh, my God.
When Rue won't do it, call me. I'll do it.
Well, good. Well,
that's hilarious.
Well, we got a lot of information here. I'm so glad you're back in the U.S. You're back with us.
Yes.
We're going to start filming very soon.
Can you believe it?
Oh, my goodness.
I can't believe it. I've lost 40 pounds now.
Since the last. And you know, on season 7, you look great.
Season 7, I'd lost 23.
Wow.
By that point.
Yeah.
So it is looking good. So I can't wait to shoot now being the same weight I was for season 3. Right now. Same weight.
Wow.
Few years older.
Uh-huh.
That's all right. But I do all my blood work. You know, this whole journey started to reverse my autoimmune. I do all my blood work coming up in June. So I can't wait to report back after I know everything.
And the diet is based on what your blood is doing?
No, I'm not doing that. Uh-huh. It's not eat right for your blood type.
Right.
I'm gluten-free and vegan trying to reverse my autoimmune disease. So
I see.
I'm just going to see what the numbers say. Is it working? After a year of doing it, right?
Yeah.
May is a year of doing it. Is it working? Or is it not? And we'll see what happens after that.
All right. Well, you'll have to report back here. Well, until next time, guys, this has been a lot of fun. We talked about a lot of stuff.
I hope it wasn't too much and too confusing.
Oh, my God. I know. It's crazy. Well, until next time, my darlings. Bye.
Can I get an amen? Can I get an amen? If you can't love yourself, how in the hell you gonna love somebody else? Can I get an amen?
And don't forget to subscribe on iTunes.
If you can't love yourself, how in the hell you gonna love somebody else? Amen.